this is John Cole with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and I'm here in Half Moon Bay, California today. And actually, it's a nice, probably foggy, which is probably most of the time foggy in Half Moon Bay, near my stomping ground since I grew up just a few cities over, Daly City, California. So what's up, my homies in Daly City? So anyways, today why I'm in Half Moon Bay is I'm here visiting the Pastorino Farms. And while Pastorino Farms doesn't exist in its original format, which basically it was a business that produced roses and carnations in greenhouses here. You guys can maybe see them in the background, under greenhouses for like a long time. I don't know how many years, but basically due to globalization, they weren't able to keep it productive and make roses and carnations, profitable anymore. So what they've done, the Pastorino family has done something pretty smart. They've actually turned all their greenhouses into they basically rented them out individually to different agricultural, organizations. So there's like a carnivorous plant one, there's a lavender one, there's a succulent one, there's Yerba Buena Nursery, and there's Ouroboros Farms, which is basically they have probably one of the largest aquaponic systems in the entire country. I don't even know how many planting sites they have. They have like some insane amount of planting sites. It's the largest aquaponic system that I've ever visited in my life, and it looks to be one of the most productive. So I got to spend literally a day here behind the scenes, looking at the farm, actually sitting in on a class that the owner was giving to just the people that come in on the intermediate class, and just sitting in on the class, I learned some stuff so that they know their stuff here. But anyways, Ouroboros Farms, you could come here and buy the produce, or you could also do a farm tour on specific days. You gotta sign up for that in advance. You could also take the classes here. And more importantly, this is a aquaponics farm that just didn't start yesterday or the year before. I mean, they've been here since 2014 in this location, and they were even in another location previous to this. And unlike many aquaponics farms that I visited, this is actually a profitable farm with a really good track record. They sell primarily focused on high-end chefs is where they sell their stuff. I mean, you'll learn how much they charge for some of the certain leaves in there, and you'll be impressed, and you will value your produce that you guys grow more in your garden because of how much they're actually getting out of some of the high-end 3 Michelin star chefs and all these other local restaurants in the area. Anyways, let's go ahead and head over to Ouroboros Farms and show you guys around. All right, so this is Ouroboros Farms, and the Ouroboros, I was like, what's Ouroboros? Is it some dude's name? What the heck? So basically there's like a symbol in different cultures of a snake, like in a circle or something, or maybe a dragon in a circle. And basically it's like this, I don't want to say it's a circle of life, but it's basically how things return and keep flowing. Maybe I'm not describing this right, but anyways, so if you look at their logo, they have actually a fish eating plants, which then turns into a fish, which then eats the plants. And that's exactly how aquaponics works. Aquaponics is a great growing method for conserving the resources of the planet, to basically, with very little input, probably the least amount of input that you could add to any kind of growing system, to get the maximum output. And they feed hardly any, just basically fish food with a few supplemental minerals in addition. And then they make so many different products out of the fish food that is transformed into plants, into fertilizer, into worm castings, into a mineral supplement. Totally amazing. And now I will say that, they're doing like a hybrid style system here. There's a UVI system that many people may use. And after sitting in on one part of the class, I was like, man, that's a very inefficient system in my opinion. And I really like the hybrid system and how they're doing it here specifically, because it looks to me that it's actually working really well. And the growth, looks a lot better than many or most other, maybe except for one, of the other aquaponic grows that I've ever been to. I mean, sometimes when I go into some different aquaponic grows, the plants just look like anemic in my opinion. I taste them, they taste, not so good in my opinion. Although you could do it, inside the farm here, I've tasted some of the greens, and it's definitely really good. I mean, if Michelin 3-star chefs are using this stuff and requesting certain ingredients and things from this farm, you guys know it's gotta be good, because those chefs, they have like really good taste buds, to source good products. So anyways, this is the outside. Let's go ahead to the front door and share with you guys more about the hours and what you guys could buy here. All right, so we're here at the front door of the farm, and look, it says, sorry, we're closed. All right, man, I'm screwed. We'll see you guys later. All right, just kidding, I got the inside pass. I've been here pretty much the whole day, and they closed, and now I'm filming after hours so we don't get any kind of, like, distractions in the video. But yeah, I spent a lot of time here learning about the farm. It's really cool. So anyways, real quick, the hours are Monday, they're closed, and Tuesday through Sunday, they're open from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m., and you can come here, and basically the owner told me that anything in here is for sale, you know, of course, for the right price. You could buy the produce here, you could buy, you know, just plugs with the plants in it, you could buy empty plugs, you could buy empty hydroton, you know, you could buy a whole complete aquaponic system to bring home. They'll sell you components of aquaponic systems. Basically, I mean, if it's around aquaponics, they'll sell you starter fish, full fish, live fish, fish that are no longer alive that you guys can eat. And here's their fish price. It's actually the trout. They grow rainbow trout here. It's $2.50 an ounce. And so, yeah, that could get kind of expensive, but it's like, you know, they're, and here's the thing, right? While they do harvest and use the fish and sell fish for $2.50 an ounce, which is, I don't even know how many per pound. It's like 25, I don't know, like $40 a pound for some of their fish, which is kind of, it seems expensive to me. You know, they're really trying to grow the vegetables because in my opinion, the vegetables are much more valuable asset than the fish because the vegetables, I mean, they could sell one leaf of a certain kind of plant for 50 cents or 60 cents or 30 cents. And that adds up really fast. It's a lot easier to grow a leaf than to grow a whole fish that can take some time to grow. And then in addition, yeah, so I mean, and they also sell the vermicompost, the worm castings, and I did give the owner some tips on how to make his worm castings even better. If you haven't seen my video on worm castings, check the link down below for the video I made on how the best worm castings that I found are made. Anyway, so they sell one quart for six or 1 gallon for $20. Anyways, let's head inside and show you guys the retail store area first. All right, so this is the retail store area, and I can't just do a single shot on the tripod for you guys because that doesn't do this whole area justice. I think for the best results, I'm gonna have to take the camera around on my hand and just do hand cam shots to show you guys around this actually pretty huge area, which, you know, I think they should probably, it has a lot of open space, which is good. I'd want to fill with something else, maybe a little bit fuller myself, maybe a few more aquaponic systems, but they got so many different demonstration systems that you can come and visit, even in this front area, because in the back area, that's for employees only, or if you want to come on a tour day, then they'll be glad to take you in the back, you know, that's where they grow all the food, you can't just go back there. And so I got special permission today from the owner to, you know, make this video for you guys. They have a sample aquaponic system here. They have so many different other sample systems. They have different products to sell. I want to go ahead and take it on a hand cam and show you guys around.
All right, so right when you guys walk in, you're going to see this main system. This main system has been sitting here and growing for about 4 years, actually, since they opened. This is probably one of the first systems they have. And they sell fresh produce. And you could harvest it yourself right now, and you could harvest any of this produce. This is for sale. You could just come in and I want that lettuce head, and you could pick it yourself and take it, and they'll sell it to you. You could actually take it with the roots on, they'll cut the roots off. You could even take it in a glass jar, so you could continue to grow it on your windowsill for, you know, even a week or two more. And that's really cool. So it's a 1 for 4, 2 for 7, or one head with a glass jar is 8 at present time. In addition, this is an example system here. So they basically have the gravel bed right here, which acts as a filtration. And then they have in the back, they have a black tank, which has all the fish in it. And then they have basically a little simple filter here. And all these work in conjunction to grow all the plants you guys see inside, as well as the raft system that's growing all the lettuce. Now, I did want to point out, so they have like these signs here. This is a little bit hidden. It says, do you like this system? It can be yours, fully installed by a professional for $3,800. Exclude fish, fish food, and plants. Harvest your own living produce. $4 per head or 2 heads for 7. Ask about other produce. Oh, so they have like lemongrass in here, some collards, and check this guy out, right? So I'll show you guys this. This has been growing for 4 years, this one plant right here. That's the stock right there you guys see. Going up, going up, going up, 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 and over. This is a dinosaur kale that has not flowered in 4 years in the system. It must really be having a good time. they keep harvesting the leaves off of it. And I mean, that is one of the, that's probably the tallest dinosaur kale that I've ever seen in my life. I want them to actually grow some tree collards in here, because that'd be really impressive. They'd probably do really well also. And so they basically just stake this up, just like a big long tomato. And they're just gonna let it grow and see what happens. So I think I just like that so much. They've just been letting it grow. So that's a one sample system. You're like, man, that's a really expensive system. They've got all these other systems. Oh, the other thing I want to point out, they have this really cool machine here that basically makes water out of the air. I've been drinking that water since I've been here. Here's their front desk here with the, you know, they sell live heads of lettuce or salad mix, as well as other produce. Any of the produce you guys see here, they will sell. And then here's another aquaponic system here. And it basically just using a half a wine barrel as where the water and the fish are. And basically that pumps up. Up these tubings to have basically an NFT system. And you can see this is a vertical system. It says the herb wall. And they have basically just different herbs in here that's being fed the aquaponics water. And then it comes back down, you know, through these pots, and then the water then recirculates. Now over to the other side of the door, they have another system, another small system here. And then they have this larger system here, which is, you know, another maybe home unit. They have an easy reach home system, which has the big tank there with the fish. And then they basically have the reservoir there. And they basically have the gravel beds in there, the media beds. And, you know, the owner here is really cool. You know, when he hears you can't do something, he's going to try to do it. So one of the things I was surprised to see is that he's growing aloe vera. And this is actually a really nice aloe vera plant. I mean, this plant is huge. I mean, this is my hand. That's the aloe vera. It's so huge. This is grown under aquaponics. And they says, oh, you can't grow succulents under aquaponics. There's too much water. Well, not for this aloe vera or the one next to it. So, you know, I'm going to have to try that. Maybe I'm going to put the aloe vera in my flood table that doesn't even get constant water. Now, the other thing they're doing that's kind of neat, I haven't seen it too many places, they're doing like a hybrid system where they're growing in a pot inside the aquaponics, and basically the pot is filled up to the level here with the hydroton, and then they have basically a burlap layer, and then they fill it up with soil. So they now have a hybrid system that they could basically top feed like different nutrients that are not going to be in the aquaponic system. So the aquaponic system could be very high in like nitrogen, but may lack other minerals that plants may need when they're flowering. So, you know, to produce fruit, you know. And so here they're mostly producing leafy greens. And these are the kind of plants that I see normally do well under aquaponics. Not every type of plant in the world will be really good under aquaponics, just certain ones. So if you're gonna get a system, make sure that the plants you wanna grow can be grown in this system, although they are pushing the envelope all the time. And here's actually another really easy system you guys could make at home. You know, and while they will make one of these and sell them to you all set up, they would encourage you guys to actually look online and find the plans and build it yourself. And you could be invested in the process and learn it instead of just get something delivered and pre-made for you. I mean, this is not rocket science. It's like 2 55-gallon drums. They put a little hole in it, run some PVC tubing. They took another 55-gallon drum, cut it in half. They made a simple 2x4 framing in it, and it's a dual barrel system. They sell for $500, but I mean, you could get these barrels for, I don't know, $20, $30 on, you know, Craigslist, make sure it's a food grade, and they fill it up with hydroton, and you gotta buy some fish, and you got a really simple system, and they got the watercress in here, they got mint in here, and then maybe got some canna in here, and they got the, it looks like an avocado, also some, the red vein sorrel, one of my favorites. You know, so yeah, this is a very simple system you guys could put together, and I would encourage you guys to do that actually. And now if a two barrel system is too much for you, then you just gotta walk over here just a little bit and you guys can see a one barrel system. This is like super ingenious, right? They just took a 55-gallon drum, cut it in half, and then basically the bottom got put onto the top, and they basically put it on top, and this is the other bottom. And basically that's the little reservoir there. And then basically the water just gets sumped up into a pump, up into the top, and just basically floods this whole little area. And then they have basically the valve there that will drain it every once in a while. And you guys can grow some plants. Now, you know, this might not cost you that much to make, and it'd be a kind of a fun process to learn the aquaponic system. Here's another system, you know, just using some totes, some Rubbermaid totes that they would normally use for, you know, feed tanks or whatever, for horses or whatever, and it's another simple system that they put together. Oh, and then if we go over here, here's even, you know, here's the back of the other system. Oh, and then I want to go over this really quick. There's so many things I've learned today. They got this little meter here, which I think is good for every aquaponic system, so you guys could measure your, most importantly, pH. Your pH in the aquaponic system should be between 6 and 7 at all times, but more, it should be more like 6.4 to 6.6 optimally. Of course, the temperature here is 67, which can be important depending on what type of fish you have. Your fish should be like to live in the temperature that you have, and if they don't, you may need to heat it. And then here's the also the connectivity. And that's the back of this this major big system when we walked in. In addition, you know, aquaponics does not have to be rocket science. You could have just a 10-gallon fish tank and pump it up into a little, media bed and just grow a few plants in it as well. That's their main system back there. Look at how big and massive this is. They got a lot of fish and a lot of plants. Now, this is for employees only. We still got a few more things to show you guys in this front area. I mean, here's another little system they have, with the water down there. It pumps up into here, into the basically a kind of a vertical system and a, you know, filter bit over here. They basically have, the walk-in. That's the walk-in cooler. You guys can see me. And they have basically all the fresh produce in there. They sell different parts for aquaponics, including the bell siphon and different pumps. And here's another aquaponic. I mean, they're all about aquaponics here. You could buy one of their shirts. And oh man, I want to go over by the front desk here. This is kind of cool. When I saw this earlier. So they sell these. Oh, they got this guy right here, which is basically they're growing the duckweed. So they will sell you duckweed here. Duckweed is a very nutritious food for not only ducks or other animals, but also us. Very high in protein. They'll sell that to some of the chefs, high-end chefs, so they could create their various dishes. And then they have this. I've never seen this before. And this is one of the things this farm does. You know, they're trying to basically increase their revenue streams because, you know, you can't just make money at farming these days. You know, they have a lot of different ways they can monetize their farm here. And one of the ways is by making dried aquaponic fish waste, $5 per bag. And this is basically just their fish waste. They basically dried, and now you guys could add it to your garden to have some of the different minerals and nutrients, but also potentially some of the microbiome that they've created here on the farm. In addition, of course, they have the worm castings as well that you guys will see, as well as the produce and the fish. In addition, as revenue streams, they also do classes. So this is actually the classroom that I sat in, and I was sitting in the back. earlier today, they gave an intermediate class, which is basically an all-day class. They also do a beginner all-day class. They also have the commercial class. So if you really want to get into aquaponics for making a business out of it and actually making a profit, this is the place I would recommend you guys come. It's a three-day course. I'm not going to mention prices in this video, but I thought it was quite affordable for a three-day course. Basically two solid full days, including dinner that you will harvest yourself here. And then the other thing is that this is a profitable business they've had running now for 5 years. So they really know how to do it. And, you know, they've been really optimizing over these 5 years. They have some really well-designed systems that you guys will see in a minute. So, yeah, this is a little classroom. And actually, there's my lunch that I will be feeding to the worms. Well, the leftovers of my lunch that I didn't eat. And then we're going to take you guys into the big farm in the back here. All right, so I got a few more things I want to show you guys in here because there's just so much to see, so much to do. And let's go over to this corner here. So over here, right, once again, they want to help people set up their own systems. They want to get people excited about aquaponics, whether it's school kids coming, whether it's just people that are on vacation here in Half Moon Bay, or anybody, right? And that's a big part of their mission is to just create awareness about aquaponics because the owner believes it is one of the solutions to farming because it is a much more efficient way of farming. They use far less water than any other farming method that I am aware of. So they'll sell you basically the hydroton clay pebbles, new in the package. But, you know, I'm not really going to recommend the new hydroton or the clay pebbles in a package. I'm going to recommend the used stuff. Man, Jordan, why are you going to get used when you could get new, right? Well, because here's the thing. They got the used hydroton pebbles, $5 per gallon, or a 5-gallon bucket for $25. Or you could get 25 liters for $21. But this one that's used is even a better deal than the new stuff. Because why? The new stuff is totally sterile, right? This is brand new from the factory. Doesn't have any bacteria or anything in there. But the ones that they've used here on the farm, which is actually a successful hydroponic system, basically has all the different living organisms, like probably in a dormant state. They'll probably just harvest some of the fresh ones if you guys want fresh ones, to have all the basically nitrogen-fixing bacteria and the other beneficial bacteria that are living in their system. You might even get some of the different worms, worm eggs, or the shrimps, you know, the little shrimps that are living in their system, to basically inoculate your system with the components that really make the aquaponic systems work, right? And this can cut down your time from your setup time from like 40 days to like 20 days if you get, you know, it basically pre-inoculated. Now, of course, I'd only recommend doing this from somebody that has a successfully running system. The other thing is, you know, they're trying to do here is they're trying to do like a, you know, zero waste facility. I don't want to say they're perfect, but they go a far way, you know. And one of the things they do is they sell the plugs for 15 cents. So these are the plugs, you know, that they sell singularly. And these are plugs that basically maybe they planted something and it just didn't quite work out. They had an issue that didn't germinate right, and they're just selling them if you guys want to use them yourself, you know, instead of throwing them away. And they're only 15 cents each, so that's actually not too bad. So yeah, they're trying to do a zero waste. All their cardboard here is actually fed to worms, and they produce a very little waste on site. Everything from their aquaponic system, for the most part, is basically reused, turned into a value-added product, and then sold out, including the fish poop. A lot of the fish poop actually gets used to feed the plants behind me, but some of it come out of the system, and in which case they sell it to you guys like you guys saw. They'll also feed that fish waste to the worms, which then the worms add additional nutrients to the fish waste, and they'll sell the worm castings, which is probably one of the best things you guys could get if you guys are farmers or gardeners, get their worm castings here. And here are some of the beautiful fish. This is actually a koi. So this is actually just for kind of like show. They do have these koi. They are working. They are eating food and pooping them out. But for the most part, they have the rainbow trout. And I guess I want to start with the tripod shots and talk more about how an aquaponic system works and, more importantly, how their system works here. All right, so before I go on, I want to let you guys know there's two things I forgot. Some revenue streams is, number one, they do farm-to-table dinners here on site. In addition, they also do the tours. I think it's like $15. You got to come on a specified tour date. You can't just show up here and say, I want to go to tour. No, you got to sign up in advance and come on the tour date when they have like a big group. And they basically just take a whole group around and basically show you guys what I'm going to show you. So if you're cheap like me, you guys can just watch this video. You're pretty much going to learn most of the things on the tour. Maybe some things added in and some things subtracted. But you guys will get the gist of what goes on here. So basically, aquaponics is the use of growing fish to use the fish waste, their poop, and more importantly their pee, that basically feed the plants behind it. And this is, it sounds really easy, but it's actually a little bit more of a complex system than that, because as the poop and pee come out of the fish, it can't directly be used by the plants unless it's converted with bacteria, microbes, and other living organisms that are living in the system currently. And so while aquaponic systems throughout the country and world are pretty much the same and work on that same concept, this system's a little bit different than some of the other systems I've seen. They've set things up a little bit differently, and I actually kind of like how they've done it here. Number one, the fish, they're using the koi, and they also use the rainbow trout. So you're like, John, they're not using tilapia, man. Tilapia is like the number one fish to use in aquaponics. So, you know, there's different kinds of fish. Many fish can be used in aquaponics. There's certain fish that are more desirable than others. Some people say that the tilapia, they're fast growing, they're really vigorous, it's hard to kill them, all this kind of stuff. But unfortunately here in California where we are, it's actually illegal to raise tilapia because it's an invasive species in this area. And the other thing is that in this greenhouse here, the weather is a little bit too cold for tilapia, so then they would have to use
expensive heaters to heat a lot of water. They have like 8 of these big tanks. I think they have like over 110,000 gallons of water in the system. So another 10,000 over there. It's like 20,000 gallons of water total. So that's like a lot of water to heat, and it would cost a lot of money just to have the tilapia so that they're more resilient or they grow faster and all this kind of stuff. And they don't want to deal with all that. And plus, it's illegal to have tilapia anyways, unless you're just going to have one as a pet or something. So anyways, they're using the rainbow trout. And in this climate here, the rainbow trout loves this weather. You know, in the greenhouse, it might get as hot as maybe 71, the water temperature when it's hot in the summertime. And other parts of the year, it's basically just, they just leave the rainbow trout in here, and they don't really have to care for them too much, you know? They're a little more finicky, they have to pay attention more to the fish, take care of them, they're not as like resilient as the tilapia, but that's what they find works here. And the fish don't grow super fast, as fast as tilapia, but the goal here is not necessarily to grow fish for the money, for the main income, is to grow the vegetables. So, you know, if you are gonna be having an aquaponic system, you have to decide for yourself what's more important to you. Do you want to grow fish, which can be successful, or do you want to grow vegetables? If you want to grow vegetables, you're going to follow this model, and if you want to grow them for fish, then you might want to follow some other models, because this is not going to, the way they're doing it here is not maximizing your fish production, but it will definitely maximize your vegetable production. And here's a crazy thing I learned in the class, actually. If you're maximizing your vegetable production versus fish production, you guys get to basically get 10 times more production out of the same amount of fish food, right? By growing vegetables instead of focusing on the fish. And because of that, you will also, in my opinion, be more profitable. But of course, that depends on your local area. If people want to eat more fresh fish that you grew, or if they want to eat more vegetables. And I think the future, in my opinion, is people eating more vegetables. I mean, you can see the news, it's all about plant-based this, plant-based that, and I'm not ever gonna tell you guys to be all plant-based, you know, and eat all plants as your diet like I do. But what I will tell you is this, I want you guys to eat more plants, eat more fresh fruits and vegetables. They are proven by science to be the healthiest foods on the planet. And the problem today is that not enough people are eating enough fruits and vegetables. Even if you're gonna eat meat, junk food, go out to McDonald's once a month or whatever you guys do, eat more vegetables and displace all the other foods in your diet to the best of your ability, to the best extent you guys can. And guess what's gonna happen? You're gonna have a healthier life, a better life, and you're gonna live longer too. And I mean, that's proven by science. You could check out a book or look up a book called How Not to Die by Dr. Michael Greger, which goes into the benefits of eating more plants in your diet, all right? And that's enough about my rant. Anyways, back to how this system works here. They focus on growing the vegetables, and we're gonna show you guys specifically how they do that to maximize your vegetable production as well as your harvest. So here's a part of an aquaponic system that I really like. And you know, every different growing system, whether it's hydroponics, aquaponics, aeroponics, you know, a soil-based system, you know, self-irrigating planters, there's so many different pros and cons to each growing method. And you know, I personally like soil-based gardening easier because it's like, it's a self balancing system, and it's a very hands-off system. If you set up the systems correctly, you could plant your plants, you could put it on water, the water comes on, it waters, and you don't have to really do much, right? Nature will self-balance. An aquaponic system, on the other hand, it was gonna take a lot more labor and time to manage it, to make sure that everything is just right, because if everything isn't just right, if one pump here burns out, it goes out and it fails, then the whole system could crash, they could lose all their fish. And actually, this is not funny, because one of the farms that I visited, that happened to them one time, they lost all their fish, and it really was a major setback, as well as a really big financial loss. So I want to encourage you guys, like they do here, you know, they've been implementing redundant systems. So they actually have two aquaponic systems, this side and then the other side with the blue tanks. This side is the green side. But what really drives all this is mainly one thing plus a few other supplementary nutrients. The main nutrient that they add is in this little container here, and I spun it off, and actually I think the fish were hearing me do this and they were getting excited, because this is the fish food, and they've really maximized you know, the growth of the plants for the fish food, and they don't really use a lot. So I mean, it's written here, it says 2 cups, and literally this is like one of those, this is smaller than a beer cup, you know, size, like the red beer cups when you're in college or whatever, or maybe it's about the same size. So it's basically 2 of these cups 3 times a day, so that's 6 cups total, which is not a lot of fish food. for the fish, and I think each tank could have, well, all four of these tanks will have about maybe 500 fish is what I figured, 400 to 500 fish, and it depends on the size of the fish and all this kind of stuff. So that's really not a lot of food. So they, you know, here's the thing, like if you feed the fish too much, then there's gonna be too much nitrogen in the system, and if you don't have enough plants to handle all the nitrogen, it's gonna cause problems for the fish, because this is a system where you feed the fish food, they make the poop then goes out into the plants pull out the fish poop, the ammonia and the nitrogen in there, and then basically the water is returned to the fish clean. But if it doesn't return clean, then that could be problematic for the fish, and they will not like it. They might even, you know, lose their lives or whatnot. And so they've really just basically got down to the lowest feeding point just to make enough nitrogen, you know, to feed all their plants, which they have tons of plants. So I'm really impressed that they're really not using a lot of fish food. This is a special aquaponics formulation for fish food. It's just not any off-the-shelf fish food that many aquaponics growers may use. And I would encourage you guys, if you guys are aquaponic growers or going to be an aquaponic grower, get a fish food designed for aquaponics, because the fish food designed for aquaponics has, you know, extra nutrients in there, not necessarily for the fish, but that are going to help to better balance out your aquaponics. So the only input besides the fish food is they do add some supplementary minerals that may not be in an aquaponic system, such as iron, right? They always have to check the iron levels to make sure they're right, and in some cases they might have to add different other kind of minerals that are not existing in an aquaponic system to their system to make sure they keep their plant growth up. So these are some of them here. I'm not going to go over any of these guys because that may vary, and some of these may be used also in their hydroponic system, where actually they do to use to start their seeds. So what I want to do next for you guys is actually take you guys through a journey of how the water flows here at the farm. It's a little bit different than other farms I've visited. So one of the things I really like about an aquaponics farm is that it basically conserves water, you know. A lot of farming methods basically waste a lot of water. There's a lot of runoff, and you lose water. And especially with, you know, especially California being in a drought, many other places being in a drought, aquaponics is probably the most efficient way and use of growing food in terms of water. Once again, pros and cons with every different growing style, aquaponics probably beats them all with water use. Water is literally the carrier of the nutrients, right? It allows the fish to live in their home that are right below me, and it's basically it carries the nutrients out to all the amazing plants behind me. And the one thing I want to talk about real quick is that oxygenation is the key to life in this system, right? And right here, they basically have a venturi valve that basically, and high pressure water comes through this valve, it sucks in air, and then basically it causes bubbles here in the tank. And if I put my hand over the venturi, you guys can see now the bubbles basically shut off. That's not good, so I'm gonna go ahead and put it back on. You guys can see all the bubbles come out. And you know, this is not like an air stone. Well, they do have backup air stones in here in case this system, if the pump goes out, it's not gonna create the bubbles, the air bubbles, which are important for the fish, as well as the plants in the beds. They do have some air stones over in there. But I think you know, more systems should use a venturi system. I like that a lot. The main issue with that is you need to have a nice powerful pump that has a good air, has a good pressure to suck in the air to cause the bubbles to occur. So anyways, after the fish get fed here, the fish eat the food, then the water then that has the fish poop in it then flows in to the next set of tanks. All right, so after the poop water comes out from the fish tanks and it comes into here, it's basically a swirl filter, so the water is swirling around, it kind of gets filtered, and this is the point where if they just turn this little valve here, all the sediment that collects, like all the big poo, goes to the bottom, and then they're able to use this, which basically this whole system runs on gravity to carry the water all the places I'm showing you guys, except for one step where they have one pump that basically drives this system. Everything else is just basically on a hill or on gravity, so the water just flows down to the lowest point. Right here, this valve, if they open this valve, it basically shoots out fish poop. I think if they run about 20 gallons out of this, then they basically get all the sediment that's been collected at the bottom out, and then they basically let that dry, and then that turns into the fish caca that you guys saw, you know, that they sell in a bag for like $5. the water that then is taken out is then reused in like maybe some of the sip beds, self-irrigated planter beds, and that's how it works. And then the other thing that's unique about this system is instead of this water from here goes into there or into there, this water from this point could go two different directions, which I think is kind of cool, and I kind of like this setup a lot. Number one, it goes through this pipe right here. This pipe here goes to all the media beds behind me, which I will show you guys. The media beds are basically where they have the hydroton balls, and they're basically just growing cut and come again crops. They plant these guys once, they will live for, you know, 6 months, a year, depending on the plant, and they'll just keep trimming off the outer leaves one at a time, selling to the chefs, selling to the local people, whatever. And then the water, after it goes through this, then gets into the next step, which we're not going to cover yet. So that's one way the water could go. The other way the water could go is through this pipe on here, which actually jets over that way into the next tank. So let me show you guys that one next. So this is the next tank where basically the water flows from that round tank into the square tank. And then they basically got all these guys, which kind of look like these big brushes that they have in a car wash. And these are really heavy. As you guys can see, they're getting collected with our particulate and different things in there. And what happens is that there's usually like live organisms inside this tank that may help keep these guys clean. I think due to they didn't have enough calcium to keep these guys alive. So now they gotta manually clean this more often than not. So if you have a good running system with all the different biology in there, including a host of different, you know, beneficial microbes, and they could have, you know, different shrimps and, you know, worms, the system will run more automated than with more labor. And one of their goals here is they know labor is expensive, so they always try to reduce the labor, you know, human labor, and get more free labor from different shrimps and other, you know, creatures that may be living in the system, you know, doing the work to help clean it, right? Nature is self-balancing, right? This is, of course, a man-made system modeled after nature, and so they're trying to get nature to work as much as it can, you know, to our benefit in this, you know, controlled environment. So anyways, after the water goes through here, it flows this direction through these guys, and then it goes into this one. It then goes to this other square tank, and let me go ahead and explain to you guys what it does. All right, so after the water has been filtered through basically two filtration setups, it comes into this setup. And basically this setup is where if they need to add some kind of extra minerals or some kind of supplements to the water, they're gonna add it here. So this is after it's been filtered from the main fish poop. It goes into here, and anything they add here then goes through this pipe, which you guys see right here, and then it runs all the way down into basically the raft beds that you guys are gonna see in a minute. So the water gets the maximum filtration before it goes into the raft beds. In addition, they'll get different you know, minerals like iron, for example, added here that then go right into the raft beds that then feed the plants. The plants then suck out any of the minerals and then basically return more clean water with some of those different supplements removed into the fish. So the fish are gonna get the most pristine and clean environment. So you guys saw that the water splits off two directions, and this is unlike many aquaponics farms that I've visited. And this is the way they did this, and I really kind of understand the concept and believe this is a better way to do aquaponics than some of the other systems I've seen, because the water as it comes through here gets pretty super clean to go into the raft system, which is important for that system because you don't want a lot of the organic matter floating in there because it's going to make the system really messy. But you know, the water that came out of the tank and then only into the swirl filter then goes into the gravel bed. So actually I want to show you guys that next, and why they're feeding the more dirty water to the gravel beds and why. All right, so as you guys can see the media beds or the gravel beds, the hydroton beds, whatever you guys want to call them. But basically what these beds do is they take that water, it's still kind of murky, you know, and I pulled up that little filter, and that's what would be in the water that's coming through into these beds. These beds kind of get the murky water. The reason why these beds get the murky water is because that murky water is still some basically undigested fish poop waste that if it then put back in the fish tank would basically toxify the fish, for a layman's explanation, because I'm not an aquaponics you know, scientist or into this stuff, you know. I'm just trying to teach it to you guys. So anyways, the fish poop with all its waste and glory goes through this bed, which goes through this pipe, and then every certain amount of feet, they basically have an outlet that basically just drains it down and it basically has a siphon valve, so the water rises to a certain level, and then it basically drains out. So it's always, you know, the water level is going up, and then it's going to go down, it's going to go up, and it's going to go down, and it's going to do that throughout the day so that the plant roots are never sitting always in standing water, unless the roots go down really deep, where there will always be some standing water in there. This is kale, chard, and collard greens. They're looking really nice and healthy to me, actually. Really nice growth, and this is the cut and come again, so they're just going to harvest a leaf, and then, you know, just let the other ones grow out until they harvest the big leaves to sell to the chefs and local people. So here's the thing, right? In an aquaponic system, the main thing you have to deal with is the fish poop, right? If you feed the fish too much, they're going to create more fish poop, which is basically more, you know, toxic matter in the water, which the toxic matter is the nutrients actually for the plants. So the plants are there to basically remove that, you know, the nitrogen from the water and get it converted to feed the plants, right? So you always want to measure the levels to make sure that you don't ever get too much, right? Anyways, this system is basically a filtration system for those nutrients, right? And it's not the plants that are eating these things. There's beneficial microbes, there's worms, earthworms in here, there's different shrimps in here that are basically taking that fish poop, digesting it, and then they're pooping out, in layman's terms, nutrients for the plants that the plants can absorb, thereby making the water clean for the fish, so that when the water goes through this system, it's taking out some of the fish toxic poop and then putting it back into the fish tank. You know, so I hope you guys follow that. That's my layman's terms explanation for you guys. So this is the way they're actually filtering the water, that some other systems, depending on how they're done, they may not have this step. Some systems omit this step, you know, and I think this step is a critical step, you know, for optimal plant growth and production. I want to show you guys some areas of actually how well the vegetables are growing in this media bed.
All right, so this is the media bed on one of their systems. This is the green side, and as you guys can see, some of the chard here, I mean, these are nice, large chard leaves, man. I don't think I've seen chard leaves like this big on other aquaponic systems that I've visited. You know, this is getting approaching size of the chard in my garden right now, grown in land. But, you know, there's a leaf, and here's my hand. So, you know, that leaf is, you know, bigger than my hand in soil grown. I could get them definitely bigger, but that is actually quite impressive for an aquaponic system. In my opinion, of course, here's some kale that they've just recently planted. And look at that chard, those nice large chard leaves, you know, that'd be perfect for using for wraps. These are really nice, beautiful plants. Some of the best grown aquaponic stuff that I've seen. Now, the other thing, if you guys see down there, that's all the raft system. They're growing different crops in the raft system, mostly lettuce actually, versus the media beds, right? And I like the flexibility because you could grow certain things in the raft beds that aren't gonna grow well in the media beds and vice versa, right? And so they're really utilizing the system to the max. Now the one comment I would give is that they should have more optimal plant spacing inside the media beds, because I see a lot of empty space. I mean, I'm really anal about planting things as close together, you know, as I can, and spacing them optimally to maximize the production. So they could do a little bit better on that point. But yeah, so they have lots of nice, really nice stuff here growing in these beds. Oh, and then I want to go over and cover this last bed over here.
All right, so this is another media bed that I want to show with you guys. Actually, all the media beds are pretty much set up the same. They basically have, you know, the different plants growing, and they just harvest leaves off of them. This one's a bit different, you know. They mostly grow vegetables here, or leafy greens, or herbs. And in this bed, they're going to do tomatoes. So many aquaponic system I've seen, they just put tomatoes in the hydroton, and you know, that could kind of work, but they noticed here at this farm here that their tomatoes they produced, if they just put the tomatoes in the hydroton, you know, they kind of grew all right. They could grow maybe 2 feet a day or something, because there's lots of nitrogen in there for the plants, and depending on the stage of the plant, like how old it is, if it's fruiting or not, it may need different nutrients. You guys that grow cannabis, you guys know this intimately well. That you know, in certain stages, you don't want to give certain nutrients because you might mess up your crop, right? So with the tomatoes, right, when they're young, it's great to have a lot of nitrogen like their aquaponic system provides here. they're going to grow great, but once you start fruiting, you need to get some, you know, some potassium in there, and the NPK, so you need the P and the K, right, in there to get these guys to make good fruit. So this is a hybrid system. They basically have the hydroton, the media, and then they have the pots, 1 gallon pots, and in these pots here, filled up to the level of a hydroton, is hydroton in these pots, right? So that's nothing different. But at the level here, then they put down some burlap, and then they put in soil. So now the roots are growing in a hybrid system, half soil, and if the roots want to go down deeper, they could also have the nutrients from the hydroton, or have the water, which is actually high nitrogen. So what they're gonna do is when these guys, you know, more towards their flowering and fruiting stage, they're gonna supplemental feed in this top area, you know, just the nutrients they want to induce, you know, better fruit production, better flower production, so they could get, you know, better fruit quality. And then they're just gonna dose it enough so that, you know, it just gets absorbed by the plants, and not much residues actually go into their aquaponic system that may mess up their aquaponic system. So this is quite unique. I've heard that cannabis growers, some of the best cannabis growers, have been doing a system such as this, which totally makes sense to me, because just under standard aquaponics, I could see how certain crops just really aren't gonna do well. So I'm really looking forward to see how this works out for them. I think this is the first time they've actually tried this as an experiment. So don't do this and don't think it's gonna really work well. But you know, the concept sounds pretty sound to me. All right, so once the water basically travels through gravity, through the media beds, then it comes into this, which is basically just goes down below the ground. It's like a tank under the ground right here where I'm standing. And I can look down in there and basically just see the water. So the water flows through that gravity bed, or the media bed, and is filtered by the plants and by the worms and by the shrimp in there, and then returns the water basically into this a lot cleaner than it came in, so that the fish have actually a nice living environment. So think of it this way. It's like if you guys lived in a house and you guys never cleaned your house, right? It would just get filled up and filth and be gross. And if you never, you know, clean anything, that's how the fish would be living if you didn't clean it. So like, you know, it's good to hire a house cleaner once in a while to come in and clean stuff. So, you know, the worms and the shrimps and the bacteria and the microbes in these media beds are basically the house cleaners for the water, so that the fish have a nice environment to live. Now this pump behind me here, this pump is what drives this whole system. If this pump goes down, this system fails. Well, there is two pumps, because there's one pump on that side and one pump on this side. But you know, the goal is they're gonna get a redundant pump, so they're gonna have two pumps instead of one, and just run each pump at half voltage to pump the same volume. So if one goes out, they still have the other one that they could crank up to full to move the same volume of water, because this one pump drives everything, including helping with the aeration of the fish tanks. So this is one way the water could go. Now the other way the water could go, I already explained to you guys the two steps. And now I want to show you guys actually the raft beds, which are actually quite impressive. All right, so now you guys can see the claim to fame, and this is really where they do lots of production here at the farm. And I want to go over some of the numbers for you guys real quick, right? So in the fish tanks, there's about 10,000 gallons of water in just the fish tanks alone. Now the whole system here has 60,000 gallons of water total in the whole system. And then they have basically 1,000 square feet of the media bed that you guys just saw. And then they have 6,000 square feet of the raft system that you guys see behind me. And look at these nice, beautiful lettuces. I mean, these are nice, beautiful, super huge lettuces right behind me. I mean, these are just filled in really nice. This looks like a carpet of green. I want to just lie on this whole thing and take a nap, but that's not allowed. It just looks so comfortable and so like fluffy and nice. But yeah, this amazing growth here at the farm. And you know, sometimes they grow lettuces a little bit smaller, because certain chefs want small lettuces. They just will serve two small lettuce heads as the salad at some places. So you know, while they like to grow nice big ones, actually the smaller lettuces are actually more profitable for them here at the farm.
So if they just optimize this in lettuce and not everything is growing lettuce, sometimes they have herbs and other cut and come again crops, even in the raft system here that I might show you guys, they could grow 12,000 heads of lettuce in one grow. There's 12,000 planting spots in this whole system, and you guys are seeing like maybe two rows, and there's like so many rows. Maybe I'll do a hand cam shot and show you guys the massive abundance of this system here. And then they could do about, they could pull off 10 harvests a year. So that means it's gonna be 12,000 plants or lettuces times 10. That's 120,000 heads of lettuce this greenhouse here can produce in 1 year. That's a lot of lettuce. And the other thing is, that's just like, that's not even covering, they still have space they could grow in, and that's just covering the lettuce. They still have all the cut and come again media beds and other areas of the garden that are not accounted in this main system area. So, you know, primarily they grow mostly lettuces in these guys because they grow relatively quickly. They do really well. They have a variety of different lettuces. They have like butter lettuce, red lettuce, you know, more frilly lettuce, green lettuce, all different kinds. I've tasted the lettuce a little bit earlier. It's actually quite amazing. Maybe actually I want to go ahead and go down to some nice red lettuce because that's my favorite. And I'm going to do a taste test for you guys on the camera and tell you guys what I think. All right, so now I thought I'd taste test for you guys some lettuce and show you guys more about how this raft system works. So number one, the thing is they're growing lettuce here on rafts, which are basically styrofoam for the most part, just floating on top. This also prevents the light from hitting the water, which is causes the algae growth, which is completely natural, completely normal. And they just basically have grown in this conveyor belt system. They start on that end, which is like very far down there. They start with little baby lettuces that are just starting to grow. And at the end here, they harvest like basically one of these styrofoam trays up. So let's go ahead and pull this up for you guys. This is what they basically harvest. They'll pull out one whole tray and they'll basically pull this out when it's done. And when they pull out one, they basically put a new one in. So this whole system is like a conveyor belt moving down. The ones at the end gets harvested. They have actually nice root structures on here. Wow, I'm impressed. The water is actually quite clean in here. They do have a bubbler right there, but this water is super clean because it did go through some of the different, you know, clarifiers and the filters before it comes in here to feed all the lettuce. So let's go ahead and carefully put that down. All right, so now I want to go ahead and sample some lettuce for you guys. And we're just going to go ahead and over here. And first I'm going to feel up the plants because I was just been harvesting lettuce out of my garden, because now my lettuce in my garden has been bolting, actually, because it's been, you know, almost pushing 80 degrees in my garden. My lettuce is not happy, plus I think I'm underwatering, which stresses out the lettuce, which means it's going to bolt faster. I've eaten a lot of lettuce in my time, so I'd say I'm almost lettuce connoisseur. And so I want to, and a lot of the lettuce I've had under other aquaponics farms that I've visited, you know, they kind of taste soft and like they're kind of like floppy, you know, they're not crisp like a romaine heart, you know, it's nice and crunchy. So we're gonna go ahead and test some of this red lettuce here. And the first thing is I'm gonna feel up this lettuce, right? I'm feeling this lettuce up and it's actually nice and firm. It's not floppy. It's like really, the leaves are kind of thick instead of really thin. Like it seems like they're really healthy to me. We're just gonna go ahead here and carefully like pluck off a nice leaf down to the stem here. And this is what we got right here. One nice leaf. Now this is a nice looking lettuce leaf to me. Make sure there's no bugs or aphids. They do only spray OMRI approved pest controls when absolutely necessary. They have a program, IPM program probably. And this is the lettuce leaf. We're gonna just go ahead and try this. Wow, I don't know if you guys could hear the crunch, but unlike a lot of aquaponic grown lettuce that I've had that are nice and soft, this has a really nice texture, and also like, I got a flavor explosion in my mouth. Like, I'm really tasting the quality of this lettuce. I mean, I can't say it tastes better than the stuff I grow in the soil, but it definitely is probably one of the best, if not the best, aquaponically grown lettuces that I've actually had in all my travels. Gotta give my thumbs up for that. Yeah, I can see why those high-end chefs are buying the lettuce here. Quite good.
All right, so now I thought I'd show you guys the massiveness of this farm here. Once again, if all of these were planted out in lettuce, they could plant 12,000 heads of lettuce. How many heads of lettuce can you eat? Like, if I could just probably take that whole raft and just juice all that lettuce and drink it straight to my head. You know, and actually I recently made straight lettuce juice, actually. It's actually quite good. I like it, actually. This is the lettuce I would juice right here. It's kind of like a romaine style. It's getting taller. They could plant these actually more closer density than some of the other ones that actually spread out, kind of like that. But this is really nice looking lettuce. I should have probably sampled some of that stuff. But as you guys can see, it just goes on and on and on and on. I mean, this is one massive grow. Looks like it's doing so well. And actually, I want to take you guys on the path. Actually, we're going to take you guys down this aisle. So if you guys can see down this aisle right here, you guys can see on this side, the lettuce is pretty big, pretty much full term, just about ready to be harvested. And as we go down and down and down, you guys will see the lettuce will be getting a little bit smaller, a little bit smaller, a little bit smaller. I think these were planted all at the same time. But if we go down over here a bit further, you guys can see they're getting a little bit smaller down here, right? And as we go down further and further, they even get smaller. All right, we're continuing down the walk here. And I want to say, you know, this farm is actually quite clean, you know, compared to other farms that I've visited. And yeah, so now you guys can see the lettuce is getting a lot smaller until we get to the end here where they're just little baby lettuces going in. And that's how it works, you know, they put in the small stuff over here, they keep running them down, and they also, you know, put the dates, you know, on there, the red butter, some of the different dates when they were germinated and planted and potted up and then moved down until they go down over that way. I mean, this greenhouse seems like it goes on and on and on and on forever.
So aside from just growing the lettuce in their raft system, they're also growing some other crops, which are mainly cut and come again crops, you know, that are quite profitable for them, although they require a lot more labor than just simply growing lettuce and letting it run down to the end and harvesting whole heads of lettuce. You know, such as this crop right here. This crop is known as the Briton Shiso. They call it Perilla, which is also the name of it. And they have one of the high-end chefs. They pay like per leaf. So they'll sell literally, you know, whatever, I don't even know how many, 100 leaves or 200 leaves of this plant. And the specific thing is the leaves have to be of a certain size or the chef will not buy them. You know, previously what would happen is this restaurant would basically have to buy like just bunches of this the shiso, and then they would basically only take off the bunches, the exact size leaf they want, and then the rest would get thrown away or hopefully composted. And so that would take a lot of time from the chefs, which, you know, they just make a lot of money, and also waste food just because they want the certain size, right? Here at the farm, they're able to do things like grow to order. They will grow the specific crop you want, harvest the specific size you want, and provide it to you. I know on one of the plants, actually the edible chrysanthemum leaves, you know, the chef wants a certain size leaf, and they pick 600 leaves to sell to the chef. It took about a half an hour to harvest the 600 leaves of the right exact size, but they sold these 600 leaves of the chrysanthemum for like $100. That basically works out to be $50 an hour, because that was like, you know, basically took some time to pick them. Or was it, yeah. So anyways, yeah, they grow the shiso, and the shiso to me in my garden grows like a weed. I have so many leaves that I wish I could monetize them and sell them for as much as they sell them here for. I forget the exact number, but certain leaves are 15 cents, certain leaves are 20, and some leaves are 30 cents. Maybe even some leaves are more than that, right? Depending on how hard it is to grow and the specifications and all this kind of stuff. But yeah, I want you guys really to value the leaves. Chefs pay high dollar for them for the flavor sensations. I think these are chaffinaded and then served or whatever. But you know, the leaves have amazing flavor profiles as well as nutrients that can benefit your health. I particularly like these guys because they're purple on the bottom. If a plant is purple, then it contains anthocyanins, which have been shown to be anti-inflammatory. So I want you guys to eat more of your purple and red foods. All right, so what you guys are looking at next is another crop that I think if you guys are growing it, you should be growing it if you have an aquaponic system, or even if you're growing it in a garden. It's actually known as the watercress, and they have the standard green variety of watercress over on that side. But I want you guys to grow the red one. Why? Because the red one has more of the purple or red compounds, which are actually anti-inflammatory. These are some really cool watercress here. Look at that leaf on that, man. I mean, that is just a beautiful leaf. And we're gonna go ahead and try this on camera for you guys. Wow, I was chewing it up for a while before I got that like peppery kind of bite. I mean, it reminds me of like eating nasturtium leaves, which actually these guys are related to them. It's kind of mild actually. This one has actually a really good flavor. I really like it. But yeah, I want you guys to grow the watercress. One of the most nutritious foods on the entire planet. It is in the brassica family of plants, which is shown to be anti-cancer as well as anti-aging. All right, so now I want to show you guys actually how the plants get put into the raft system. Basically, they started from seeds. Here's some from seeds. Johnny selects seeds. I think they are pelletized seeds. They basically take the pelletized seeds and they just basically put them on this little tray. And what this tray is called, this is called a Berry Cedar Company. This is basically a vacuum cedar. So they turn on a little shop vac that's over here, and there's little holes that suck the seed down. So they just spread seeds, they'll get sucked down, they'll pour off the extra that didn't get into a hole, and then we'll take their pre-made flat that they buy from the supplier, and they basically just put this on top, and because there's vacuum while these seeds are staying, they'll put this on top here. Then they'll basically cut the vacuum off, they'll let this, take this up, and then guess what happened? All the seeds that were stuck on here are now in the little holes exactly where they should be, and then now this tray is ready to basically get germinated. Now they formerly did just germinate the seeds in this greenhouse here, but they have very sporadic growth, you know, and because they've been here now for 5 years, they've really dialed in their systems, you know, to maximize their profits and maximize, you know, wasted time. And, you know, and this is what they get to teach you guys if you guys come to one of their classes, especially the commercial class, on how they've been able to do it successfully. But instead of that, they actually build a special germination room with an air conditioner to get it to the right temperature for lettuce, which I think is in the, you know, maybe like 67 degrees. That's where lettuce likes to germinate at. So they take this into the germination room, which maybe we'll just show you guys the door. It's a little bit chilly there today. All right, so as you guys can see, I'm in the germination room. The lights are really bright. They're basically beaming on all the seeded trays here that have the plugs that are ready to go in their system outside. And in this room, they control not only the temperature, but also the humidity to give the seeds the exact right climate requirements so that they can germinate successfully. It looks like to me they're getting fairly good germination results. I think I see like one, maybe two, three, four, five out of this whole tray. I think it's like over 200 little starts in there. That's definitely some good germination here in here. And then the other thing is, you know, they don't allow any kind of like, you know, they keep doors shut, so this keeps any kind of like little bugs out so that they don't affect these little baby plants when they're the most tender and the most vulnerable. So once the seeds have been germinated inside the germination room, they've been growing in there for a number of weeks, and then when they're the right size, they actually come out into the greenhouse to basically get hardened off in this area of the greenhouse, which basically is a flood table. Now this table specifically is not using the same aquaponic water that they're using in their entire system there, you know, because it's not quite balanced properly for this stage of growth for these little seedlings that are just now emerging and gonna get bigger. So this area actually has a specific hydroponic system where they use hydroponic nutrients, which is tailored to have the right nutrient profiles for these little seedlings to grow and get out to a nice developed state. In which case, at that point, then when they're bigger, then and only then do they get moved into the main system there. But they found by basically putting in this system here, instead of taking the seedlings out and putting them right into their rafts, they can increase their production by like 30% by just simply putting in this extra bed. In addition, they were previously using just the aquaponics water, and they found they had some more extra challenges with diseases with some of these baby seedlings, you know, before they started to build up a nice immunity and immune system. So in doing it in this way, they get a lot better growth and a lot faster growth. And then from this system, the hydro system, they put in the aquaponic system to get it to really ramp up the growth, you know, once they're more mature. All right, so aside from just the standard aquaponics, they're growing in the media beds as well as the rafts. They're growing in other ways, and it's always experimenting here at the farm to see, you know, what they can do, how far they could take this. And this is one of the ways they're doing this. Water behind me, they have basically three SIP, S-I-P. I like to call them self-irrigated planters or sub-irrigated planters. Basically, these are like raised beds, but they're basically lined with a pond liner. So they're basically like a self-watering container, but on a much larger scale. You know, I visited another aquaponics farm, I think they're in Texas, and the farmer there told me, John, I mean, he's a die-hard aquapon, but he said the future really is in this style of gardening or growing food, because it conserves water also, just like the aquaponics does. But they basically take this concept and make it even better by basically feeding the aquaponic water to these beds, to basically feed these beds, you know, some of the same nutrients that are in their aquaponics grown, but also they have like a nice rich organic soil mix, and also will supplement that with their worm castings, which we'll see in a second, to grow some of the root crops that won't necessarily grow in, you know, the two systems, the media system or the raft system that they have. I want to explain to you guys actually how one of these beds works. So basically they just have a wooden bed. This is sitting on top of the ground here, and they basically line the inside with a pond liner, and then up to a certain point they basically have a gravel on the bottom, and then they basically have an overflow tube on the other end. And then they have a spout here, or the tube where you put the water in. So you put the water in, it basically covers all the rocks down here, and then if you fill it too much, it just goes out the overflow, so the water level will never be above this, right? Above this, and they have like a membrane, basically they have a weed fabric so that the rocks and the dirt don't mix, and then it just gets, everything gets muddy and in a wreck. And then on top, they basically have all the organic soil mixture on top. So what happens is the bottom is all wet, the soil will basically soak up some of the water and wick it up into the bed. And if we just feel down in here, the top 3 inches are dry, but if we go down a little more below 3 inches, it's actually really nice moisture content in here. So if you're one of those people like me that tends to either overwater or underwater, because I don't often get it just right, this is the bed for you. And you know, once again, this gardening style has pros and cons. I mean, it's going to conserve water more so than others, although every different type of produce may not be able to grow in this exact environment, although this environment looks great for growing what they're growing, which is the root vegetables, and also probably could grow many other different types of vegetables as well. All right, I'm getting hungry, so I thought it'd be time for another taste test, but also show you guys what one of the radishes looks like that they're growing in this very bed here. We're just going to go ahead and pull this guy out right here. And actually, look at that, that's one nice radish. Now the cool thing about radishes, maybe you guys knew this, maybe you guys didn't, is that they are a quick turn crop. What do I mean by quick turn crop? That means you can basically put the radish seed in as little as like 30 days, maybe even 20 days, depending on the variety of radish. You guys could have this whole radish ready to grow, ready to eat actually, and harvest. So now they could offer, you know, radishes, you know, different kinds of radishes and turnips and different root vegetables to some of the chefs. And I'm just gonna go ahead and try this. Wow, nice and crunchy. I'm not feeling a lot of heat, but it's actually has a really nice sweetness that I haven't experienced before in a radish. And look at the middle. I don't know if you guys can see that close up, but man, this is definitely a nice, watery, rich, delicious radish. I would love to pickle these guys, because pickled radishes, Japanese style, is one of my favorite ways to eat them. All right, so the last few things I want to share with you guys. Number one is they do vermicompost here, make worm castings. They basically raise worms in these totes here, and the worms are for a very important reason. You know, when they have excess fish poop that they actually get out when they settle their tanks and get all the settled stuff at the bottom, if they don't want to bag it up and sell it, they can actually then take it and feed it to the worms, right? I mean, many worm castings can be made out of different manure products. I'd say that probably the fish manure is probably one of the better manures to make the worm castings out of, although I think ideally, optimally, for the best worm castings, there should be more of a plant-based casting, you know, using a host of different ingredients. But they feed the fish waste to the worms, as well as all the cardboard that they get shipments in, basically goes into the worm bins here, as well as the produce scraps, things that are non-sellable, that may have gotten some damage or whatever, go in here. And so I'm gonna go ahead and show you guys actually the worms. They basically have one, two, three, four bins. I think two of the bins now are currently in the feeding stage, where they're actually adding active, you know, food scraps to, and then two of them are actually in the harvestable stage. So we're gonna give you guys a close-up of actually what one of the harvestable bins look like, and what one of the bins that is still being fed looks like.
All right, so now I want to show you guys actually one of these worm bins. And actually, this is how one of the commercial farms that I visited has worms. It's like these big produce bins that ship like whatever big pallets of produce. And they basically just made a lid out of a plywood with a little handle. We're just going to go ahead and lift that up for you guys. And you guys can see the cardboard that they use kind of like as a top for the worm castings and basically everything that's been broken down inside here. This one's pretty much ready to be harvested. I'm sure they will sift it out and then they'll make the worm castings and then they can sell to you. And if they don't sell them to you, then what's going to happen is they will use them in their those beds I just showed you guys, the self-irrigated planters or sub-irrigated planters here. We just take a little hoe here or trowel and show you guys, like, look at all the worms in there. I mean, I'm just moving this and I mean there's just worms for days in here, like eating all the produce scraps. And oh my god, look at all the worms in there. This is a nice, really active worm bin, man. If it was me, like, what I'd do is, I mean, there's so many worms in here, I really wouldn't want to disturb them so much. I'd want to somehow, like, feed them more and get them to come up into the new food and then take that food and move them away. Or actually what I'd do is I'd probably put a bright light on here, and if there's a bright light in here, then they're going to want to go down to the bottom, and then I'd only scoop the layer on the top to harvest them, because otherwise they're going to lose a lot of the worms depending on how they harvest. I didn't go over their harvesting techniques, but yeah, there's so many worms in here, it's actually quite amazing. And then once again, they're fed the fish poop and they're being fed all the produce scraps.
All right, so here's an active worm bin, and I could verify what they're feeding the worms. So I definitely see lots of different, you know, produce scraps. Like, here's a head of lettuce that kind of looks messed up. Here's the cardboard they're feeding that's been covered up with all kinds of stuff. And I'm gonna make a deposit today, and this is basically, the radish that I just ate, you know. Now, while you could eat the radish leaves, and I would encourage you guys to chop these up and put them in salads, they're actually anti-cancer. You know, I'm not gonna eat them today. The radish is good enough. So we can just drop that in and that's gonna get composted. And then this is the food scraps from my lunch, right? I only eat compostable things generally. And so this is basically what I had for lunch. This is known as jackfruit. This is all the scraps. Some parts were bad. There's seeds in here. There's the skin in here. And this basically is gonna be like a gourmet food for the worms. So they're gonna get to enjoy all the scraps that I didn't get to eat. So I'm making a contribution to the worm bin here, and once we put all that stuff in there, we're just gonna maybe cover it up just a little bit so to give the worms a nice place to go and feast. The other thing is that I would encourage the farm here to feed more cardboard to the worms, even like shredded cardboard, or make a cardboard slurry, by blending cardboard with water to get the smaller particle size so they can feed more cardboard, which from interviewing worm casting experts, they said feeding more cardboard will increase the quality of the worm casting, so you'll get more explosive growth. The other thing I recommended here is because they have shrimp in their system, sometimes when they're cleaning filters and washing things out, they see all the shrimp shells that fall out. That's another excellent thing. High chitin material should also be fed to worms to make a higher quality worm casting. I think as I'm on recommendations now, the other thing I would do is not necessarily add it to the worm castings here, but I would add some kind of kelp to their whole aquaponic system to introduce extra trace minerals into the system, into the plants, into the fish. And also, of course, when the fish made their poop and the wastewater would also have some more trace minerals, which would then end up feeding the worms. So are you guys getting to see how this whole cycle is a big loop? They're using fish waste, they're using the fish water to basically grow all the food. And all this comes from, for the most part, just the 6 scoops of the fish food that they feed the fish, you know, per tank each day. So that's amazing, they're getting all these things from just a little bit of fish food. That's why I say, you know, the aquaponics is basically, it takes the least inputs to make the most outputs. And as much as I'm saying that now, I've also visited farms where, you know, it just doesn't look as good as this farm. This farm is really dialed in, they've learned what they're doing. They kind of have like engineers and they're kind of scientist-y here, and they really figure things out and improve things over time. They're always running experiments here at the farm, which is something I really like, instead of just somebody following the path and, hey, I'm doing this, I'm never gonna experiment because I know what I know works. They're always trying to move and find the next best thing to make this farm a better place and to make it more sustainable, because, you know, the owner basically got into this because he saw food deserts and he wants access to food and food sovereignty, you know, be available for everybody. And he believes aquaponics is probably one of the top answers to do just that. All right, so I know you guys might be thinking, right, thinking, John, man, this farm's ultra cool because they're making their own compost tea right behind me. Well, actually, you would be wrong, but this is kind of like a compost tea setup, but it's not making compost tea. What they're doing is they're actually making a high mineral fertilizer out of their fish waste by putting it into this this system here with the IVC totes and these pumps here that's just recirculating the water. And basically put the fish waste and water in here for about 28 days, maybe about a month, and they just keep circulating the water 24/7, and basically all the different the organic matter will basically get leached out or get broken down. And what they're going to be left with after about a month is basically just the just concentrated minerals from the fish poop. So, you know, there's instructors at different universities have been, like, you know, doing this method for a number of years, and this basically will concentrate some of the nutrients that are already in the system in a much more compact form, so they can take this and actually feed it back to their system to increase some of the minerals in there, or they could use this water to you know, irrigate other crops, do it in their sub you know, their wicking bed planters, SIP, the sit beds, you know, lots of uses of this. In addition, they could also sell this mineral-rich fertilizer to other farms in the area, once again creating another revenue stream. You know, I think it's been really smart how this farm is really maximizing the fish food, because really that's all they're doing. They're taking the fish food, they're feeding the fish, and because of that, they're basically making so many different products. They're making lettuce, they're making cut and coming in products, they're making the ones in the media beds, they're making the sip beds or the wicking beds. They have the worm castings here. They got the mineral fertilizer here. They got, you know, people coming in where they're giving classes because they learn how to do this, and they give introductory classes, intermediate classes, and of course classes for people that really want to start a business. And they learn, you learn everything from how to grow the fish, how to grow the plants, how to process them, as well as, more importantly, how to sell them. As much as I think farmers are great and they're great at sometimes growing food, they may not be the best business people, and they have such an amazing team here with a farmer, you know, on staff, as well as a really sharp business person that really makes all this come together, you know, the owner. And actually, you know what? We have a special treat for you guys. We're going to go ahead and interview him next for you guys on this episode. So now I have the pleasure of interviewing Ken Armstrong, the owner and farmer of the farm that you guys got to see today. So thanks, Ken, for having me out today. I appreciate you taking literally part of your day for me.
Oh, certainly, and my pleasure to have you and invite you to the farm and have you look around and share it with me.
Yeah, no, I've been having definitely fun. I mean, this is how I spend my free days, my days off. I visit farms for fun. I'm kind of nerdy, I guess. But so anyways, I got a bunch of questions for you. Like, why would you get into aquaponics of all things in the world? I mean, there's so many different ways of farming, but aquaponics, I mean, it can be quite challenging. And I bet you've had, over the many years you've been doing this, a lot of challenges you've had to overcome, and you probably have some pretty good losses too sometimes.
Oh yeah, without a doubt. Yeah, it's been an incredible journey. I got inspired by aquaponics via a YouTube video, Will Allen of Growing Power.
Sure.
A video on that, and I saw that and said, wow, this is amazing, and had that question, why isn't everybody doing this methodology of farming? And started doing some research and realized not many people were doing it on any sort of scale, so I saw the opportunity to be part of the change that I wanted to see in the world and sort of put my money where my ethics were and jump in on the ground floor of an industry, a commercial industry in this sense, to see if I could make that change in the world. Wanted to see if I could create a business model, a successful business model with aquaponics and help feed people all over the world.
Wow, amazing. Now, I do have to say I did go to Will Allen's place because I was inspired by his videos also. I was not allowed to make a video there, but I think I just take still pictures. But I did taste his food there, and I want to let you know that the food here tastes way better, sorry Will, than his stuff there. Because, I mean, you have it a lot more dialed in my opinion, you know, than what he's doing.
Yeah. So. Well, it's been an amazing journey. I mean, we've been doing this for 6 years, or 7 years total. Actually, April 10th will be our 7-year anniversary of the actual farm. This is our second location. We began in a town called Pescadero, which is about a half an hour south of here. And operated a facility there for a couple of years, and then the opportunity came to move to this location, which is a much, much better location. Really allowed us to take that experience that we had where we were and translate that experience into the system that we built here and the growing procedures. And because when we started, we didn't know anything we were doing. I didn't know anything about business. I didn't know anything about growing food. And so it's been a journey of ups and downs as well. I bought myself a business and I bought myself a job to a certain degree, but we learned by doing, and I particularly learned by doing this. And it's been an incredible journey with many successes and some failures along the way. But of course, we always learn more from our failures than we do from our successes.
Yeah, and I would encourage you guys, you know, don't be scared of failure. You know, it's good to fail unless it's like, you know, unless you're, I don't know, well, it's good to make some small failures. Don't ever like try to like ruin everything and fail everything. But so what has been some of your biggest successes and failures here at the farm?
Start with the failures and go to the successes. We've had a bunch of crop losses. There have been times where not really understanding in the beginning, especially as the system's starting to work and really understanding the soil or the water microbiology and the water quality issues that go with this, and having times where we have boom cycles and then bust cycles. There have been times where we've had fish kills where either through component failure or through disease or something that's gotten in the system. But from each of those, we learned and grew from it and learned how to really dial our system in so that those losses are minimized. Our successes, probably the greatest success for me personally is being able to sell to Michelin-starred restaurants. We sell mostly to local restaurants here, brew pubs and other types, but we also sell to both a 2 and a 3 Michelin-starred restaurant in San Francisco. So as a small artisanal grower, to have one of the highest rated chefs in the entire world, to be able to custom grow for them and grow the things that enable them to really take their mastery and their art in being able in food preparation, the creativity they do, and for them to recognize and honor the quality of the ingredients that we can provide for them is really a great honor. It's been one, and for me, I feel is one of the greatest successes that we've had.
Wow, that's amazing. You've learned a lot of things from your successes and also your failures, or mostly learned from your failures and, you know, gained from your successes. But one of the cool things about you is that you also give classes. Actually, I sat down on your class earlier today. I thought it was an amazing class. I would encourage you guys actually and recommend it. So you want to share about the classes that you teach based on what you've learned, but also more importantly, what you've experienced? Because I know some people teaching aquaponics might teach more theory and, hey, we do this at the university like this, but in the real world, sometimes things, in my opinion, are a lot different when you're in the trenches.
Yeah. Oh, without a doubt. So we do teach a variety of classes. We teach a half-day beginner class, which just covers the basic of aquaponics and also includes a farm tour. So we'll spend about 2 hours walking through the farm, very similar to what you did today, going through each of the different components and sort of explaining how the whole system works together. We do an intermediate class, which you were able to sit in on today. And that is an all-day class where we really delve into the minutiae of aquaponics. We talk really about fish and plants and microbes and different types of systems and how different types of components and how they all work in this symbiosis to create the wonderful quality of produce that we do here. We also teach a 3-day course as well, so it's more geared towards the commercial farmer. Most of the stuff we teach in our beginner and intermediate courses aren't even covered in the beginning class. We really get into depth in that commercial class as well. And there's a lot more hands-on activity with that commercial class as well. Not only do we teach you the basics and really the fundamentals and aspects of sales and marketing and the business aspects of it, but fish health and fish management and plant management and plant productions and that thing. But part of that great part of that class too is we want to share those experiences. So part of that class as well, the students will harvest fish out of our system and show them the proper and most humane way of actually harvesting those fish. And then they will also harvest some of the produce that they will enjoy that night. The last class we did, in fact, our chef partner that we work with said, hey, students, what do you want to have for a salad? And so the students went out into the farm and they picked whatever types of produce that they wanted to be included in that salad. So it's a really great opportunity to have that hands-on experience. And as you said, it's an experiential thing. We've been doing this for 7 years. They said there's a lot of theory out there, but there are very, very few farmers that have actually been doing this practically for any extended period of time. So that's one of the great things that our class is able to offer. We teach the classes right here at the farm, so we have our classroom right at the thing, and you look out and you can actually see the farm. So we talk about the fundamentals and the aspects of this type of growing, and then we go out into the farm and we see the practical application of it. And one of our goals is to share our experiences with people everywhere. Because we've learned by doing, and so we want to share that experiential knowledge with our students as well, and hopefully inspire them to get into the aquaponics business, or if not into a business aspect, to just learn how to grow their own food, whether it's with aquaponics or some other growing methodology, and share that experience with them that we've learned over the 7 years that we've been doing this.
That's cool. Yeah, I mean, you know, in my opinion, if I was wanting to get into aquaponics, I would totally go to the commercial class. Because, you know, you're learning from somebody that's done it, that's already successful and financially viable, which is another thing I don't often see in aquaponics. Some farms I see, they're kind of struggling, but, you know, from some of the numbers that I've heard from you, but I don't know everything,
you know, you sell for some of your produce for, you know, quite a good penny, you know, and probably do pretty good. I mean, and this is also California where the cost of living is high, cost of rent is high. And so, I mean, if you're really making it work in the Bay Area, you're doing something right. Plus just listening to your teaching skills, I was, you know, quite impressed on what you're sharing. I've learned a few things actually from you today. So thank you.
No, thank you. Certainly. I appreciate that.
Yeah. So, talking more about the aquaponics system, and how do you see aquaponics as a future for farming, you know, just out there in the world in terms of just overall agriculture?
Yeah, I think it's one of the components in the agricultural paradigm shift of the future. We live on a finite planet that has finite resources, and we have to use those resources as responsibly as possible. Now, you're not going to do grain crops in these type of systems. Wheat, barley, rye, oats, those are best suited. Corn, best suited for large acreages of land where you can sow 10,000 acres in a day and you can reap 10,000 acres in a day. Easily storable in grain silos, easily transportable, not very perishable. So best suited for those large acreages of land. But aquaponics, because we do the powerhouse of aquaponic systems are leafy green vegetables, that as soon as you cut them, they start losing their nutritional value. The average time between produce getting into the hands of the consumer is about 13 or 14 days. So aquaponic systems, because you have really intensive agriculture and you can grow a lot of food in a very small amount of space, they're really geared towards urban areas where you can bring this leafy green production closer to these urban areas, get the product into the hands of consumers faster, so they get a fresher, longer lasting, more nutritious product and there's a lot less spoilage. We've had some customers tell us that a head of lettuce will last them 6 weeks properly stored in their thing. Even our cut salad mix will last a couple weeks as well. So we're minimizing food wastage costs. We're reducing food miles by bringing this really high quality produce into urban markets. And so I think having these systems and sort of helping support community supported agriculture and getting these high quality products into the hands of consumers faster, which means you get a more nutritious product and a higher quality product. There's less spoilage or wastage, so we're eliminating food wastage costs and not impacting landfills with food that just gets wasted.
Awesome, yeah, and then of course here you guys are composting with worms, you know, all the food scraps and things that are not good, and of course, you know, the food scraps, or if they have excess that are not be able to be sold, that you guys do donate that to food banks, right?
Yep. Yes, exactly. So one of the unique things about aquaponics is all the waste products out of these systems can be monetized. That's one of the unique things about aquaponics. We use approximately about $5,000 worth of fish food per year, and that generates the plants that we grow in this facility, but it also generates $20,000 to $30,000 worth of fish sales out of that. As you mentioned as well, we capture all of our waste product. We capture all of our fish waste. We compost all of our green waste. We use it to create vermicompost. We use it to also create really high quality, very concentrated fertilizer as well. So the interesting thing about aquaponics is different than any other type of growing methodology is the waste products that are created out of the system actually can be monetized and generate far more income than the fertilizer or nutrient input that goes into the system.
Cool, and I think another component of your farm here is actually the education. You know, you're not tucked away in some back corner of some lot in the middle of nowhere, and you don't say no visitors. You know, like you have an open door policy, you know, provided somebody pays for a tour and they can come on and, you know, people could look in and see the whole farm. I mean, it's just a really nice place to be. You want to talk about how important education is as a component for you personally as the owner and for the public at large?
Oh, certainly. One of our goals right from the beginning of starting the farm is we wanted to share our growing experiences everywhere. We felt we were going to be pioneers in this industry and hopefully set sort of the ground floor. And we didn't want to be competitive. We wanted to be collaborative. We wanted to be able to share all of our growing experiences with people everywhere. So we open up our farm to people. You can do both a public and a private tour. We do public tours twice a month, usually on Saturdays, twice a day during those days at 10 a.m. and 2 p.m. And we charge $15 for those tours. You can also, if those dates don't work for you, you can always arrange a private tour as well. So if you find yourself in the local area and want to come and take a tour of a farm, just shoot me an email or just contact us through our website, and I'd be happy to arrange a time that would be convenient for you and us as well, where you can come. And the tours are most often led by me or by my farm manager, who's been working with us for a couple of years as well, and very knowledgeable people. So we're happy to share our farm with you and share our growing experiences. We're all about education. We want to teach that future generation of farmers. We need to, in a lot of ways, change the way that we grow our food, or at least in the very nature, make our food system much more transparent. Our goal this year is I want to be your farmer. That is part of our goal here. We've lost that connection with where our food comes from in a lot of cases. We, you know, ask people who's your farmer, and they say, oh, the grocery store. But we want to build that personal connection both with our restaurant chefs and individual consumers and individuals as well, to really understand where food comes from, how it's grown, what is going into that food production system, so that we can create transparency and create education and opportunities for people to really understand where their food comes from and make informed choices about their food, because food is medicine and food is life. And that's one of those most basic staples of life that exists. And our bodies are temples and or engines, and they only work as efficiently as the fuel that we put into them, which is the food that we eat. And being able to encourage people and inform people about the nature of food and how things work, and be able to help them provide to see how their food is grown, and come here and actually buy food directly from our farm. You can walk in here and buy food from us. Say, hey, I want a bunch of kale. We'll go out into the farm and we'll harvest a bunch of kale for you, fresh right out of the system. So you can come and talk to us and say, hey, how do you do this and what do you do here? We're totally transparent, totally open with what we do. So you become an informed consumer. If you like our story, you like our food, you like what we do, great, buy our product. If you don't like what we do or don't like our food, don't buy our product. But you're an informed consumer, and now you're making an informed choice, and that is ultimately our goal.
Wow, yeah, I mean, I think we need to have a transparent food system. And if we did, you know, I think people's shopping habits would be a lot different. Like, one of the things I envision, or what I'd like to see one day, is that every product in the grocery store has a little button, and you press the button, and then on top of the product, you see a little screen or hologram come up, and you see the life cycle of how that product was produced. Mm-hmm. You know, whether it's a cow and the factory feedlot that it's been farmed on, the GMO corn and soy that it's being fed, you know, how it had fear instilled within it when it's being, you know, harvested. I mean, and just see the process, right? Because it's just so behind closed doors. See the face of the people killing the animals and how they're just doing it for money, and they just probably don't. I mean, I wouldn't enjoy that job. Or whether it's, you know, your tofu burgers or whatever, and how you get these processed soy products, how the soybean was taken, and then they extract this one nutrient out of it, and they add it back in, and just so many foods are processed to the hilt, and things are factory farmed, and people have no clue. So I really appreciate the work you're doing here. Oh, and the other thing is, you know, can schools, like if somebody's out there watching is a teacher, live in the Bay Area, can they bring their students here? Because, I mean, above all, hey, educating adults is great, but I think really the future is in the kids, and getting the kids to realize that, you know, aquaponics should be one of the main components of changing the farming system, and there needs to be more successful aquaponics farms just like yours.
Certainly. Oh, yeah. We love having school tours. We've done over the years, we've done over 100 school tours. We do them anywhere from kindergartners up to university levels. We have a couple of local community colleges that every semester they bring their students here for a tour as well. So our doors are always open as well for school groups. Again, we want to encourage that next generation of farmers and really get their connection. You ask a kid, where's the carrot from? Oh, it comes from the grocery store. No, this is, and we can show them how this food is actually grown and really develop that connection with kids and children and those future farmers. So yeah, if there are any teachers out there, we are more than happy, and we love doing school tours as well.
Wonderful. So, you know, to me, aquaponics is just another growing technique. You could use raised beds, you could use field grown, you could use aquaponics, you could use hydroponic, you could use aeroponic. There's so many different ways to grow food, and, you know, I'm never going to say, well, I like soil-based better, but every method has its own sets of pros and cons. So Ken, tell me, as an aquaponics farmer, what is truly different and unique about aquaponics?
One of the truly unique, I mean, the advantage in some of these are similar to hydroponics, where you get faster growth rates. I mean, most of a plant's growth goes downward through its root systems, and because we provide the nutrients at all times, that plant, it has everything it needs, so it puts all that energy into top growth. So we get about 50% faster growth. They don't have to compete with other plants for those resources, where we plant them a little more densely. And it's one of the most water-efficient methodologies currently used. Because we're recirculating our water all times, it's about 90 to 95% more water-efficient. So we found our farm, and the way that we've constructed, we're about 15 times more land efficient and about 20 times more water efficient than a lot of traditional soil-based agriculture. Another, as I mentioned before, one of the other unique aspects of aquaponic farming too is just being able to monetize or reutilize the waste streams. Where our goal, as much as possible, is to be a zero discharge facility. We don't want anything to leave this facility that isn't food or fish that's going to market. So we compost all of our green waste, we compost all of our fish waste. We're minimizing our need for impacting or utilizing local utility services, while at the same time not impacting the local environment at all. So all those things sort of combined provide a very unique growing methodology. And I agree with you, there are a lot of methodologies. This is not the be-all, end-all. They're different. There are some challenges with this as well. You're dealing with three different living ecosystems, but having the ability to have both protein in the form of fish, if you choose to use a food fish, you don't. You can use an ornamental fish. That works perfectly fine. But the another advantage there is having the ability to have a protein source along with your vegetable source. We're going to experiment hopefully with a little bit of rice, so now we can get our grain crop in there as well. So now the idea is maybe you could create an entire balanced food diet from one entire farm and one type of growing system that not only does that. Another great thing about aquaponics that's kind of unique is they're naturally food safe. Fish do not harbor E. coli or salmonella pathogens. So as long as we have good food safety protocols and make sure that we keep a good biosecure facility, the opportunity for those type of pathogens aren't possible to get in these systems. So there are a lot of definite advantages to aquaponic growing.
Awesome. Yeah, I mean, the other protein-rich food you're growing here, which I covered a little bit, I didn't talk about in detail, is the duckweed. You know, I visited the nutraceuticals conference in Las Vegas, and there's a company that basically grows duckweed in Florida that I hope to visit and make a really nice video there of how they grow duckweed, process it, and basically turn it into a powder with the water removed, so it's really concentrated protein source. So that means that'd be another revenue and also another protein you're growing here on site for those of you guys that don't want to eat, you know, fish and just look at them because they're really nice to look at. All right.
Yep.
So Ken, I know your time is running out, it's getting dark, but you know, I want to ask you a few more things. So how has aquaponics changed your life?
Oh, it's been an incredible journey. I never imagined that I would ever be a farmer. I mean, all of us, we go back a couple generations, all the people in our families are farmers. But it's been a journey. It's been an incredible learning experience. I've learned a lot about business, what it takes to run a business, what it takes to manage people, what it takes to grow plants in this type of way. It really, my journey began in a lot of ways with some health issues as well, and realizing that it actually was, the source of it was a lot of the foods that I was eating. So really understanding what goes in my body and being able to really support food security and food sovereignty as well. The idea of having foods grown in ways we find personally and culturally acceptable. There's no transparency in our food system, so being able to have control over my food supply and understanding exactly what goes in that food. Nothing goes onto this food that I don't feel comfortable eating, that I don't feel growing for people, growing for other people. One of the things I learned and been inspiration, being a farmer, it's an honor and also a responsibility. We are providing sustenance for people, that one of the things, and so there's a lot of good care that goes into it. So it's really literally helped me grow personally in a lot of different ways, and not only being able to provide food for people, but also knowing that what I'm doing is helping other people, providing good, healthy, quality food as well. Helping to try to change the food paradigm system and really educate people as well. So it's been a wonderful journey and just being able to all that personal growth that comes out of this type of system, both there, literally, I mean, it's a pun intended, there's so much growth that happens here, but it's not only growth that happens with the food, but it's growth that happens with us individually. One of the most unique things about an aquaponics system is as you work with it and it doesn't matter the size or the scale of it, you become attuned to it. You become integrated into that system. You become a part of it. And so I love coming here. It's the first job that I've ever had that I never say I don't want to go to the farm. Sometimes I'm tired, obviously there are things new, but I love being here. And when I take a break, I don't go outside and hang out. I go hang out by the fish tank and I watch the fish. So it's a very calming, a very peaceful place as well. And a lot of the people that come here sort of feel that as well. And so that's one of the goals that we've tried to create here, is just to create a very welcoming, open, transparent environment where people come here and they can feel good about the food that they're eating and feel good about the way that the food's being grown.
Wow, yeah, and I mean, I never thought that I would be making YouTube videos in my spare time for fun to educate this about people, or I never thought I'd be a gardener and have my whole backyard and be my own personal farm to grow my own food when I was in high school, even college. Like, this is the furthest thing. But you know, I've realized also how important the food is that we eat, and that's what really got me motivated into growing food and also teaching you guys, because I know how important it is. I'm willing to take time out of my day to spend time with Ken so he could show me, and I could basically convey this on YouTube so all you guys could see it, and this could just spread like wildfire. So if you guys really like this video, hey, please be sure to share this with somebody else. Actually, I met somebody today, I think they saw my video and they were here at your class. Actually, yep. They got inspired by a video I made at another aquaponics farm.
Yep.
And you know, I just want you guys to get interested in gardening, growing your own foods. You know, whether you want to start a business doing this, hey, great, learn from Ken, he'll teach you the right ways to do it. But Ken, our time is coming to an end, but are there any questions or any, what's the single most question that I didn't ask you that I should have, and what would be your answer?
Oh, jeez. Oh God. Is there a future expansion potential in the farm? And yes, part of the goal here too. Again, we've created a really nice home system here as well. And I've been working with a developer and an architect for the last several years, really trying to dial it in. And we've actually created a 21st century greenhouse model of this type of farm. So we're taking what we've learned here. And then the idea is we're actually planning on building a large-scale controlled environment greenhouse that is going to be completely self-sustainable. The whole entire facility is going to be run off of solar panels. It's going to have rainwater catchment. It's going to have humidity recapture, very similar to the human dehumidifier that we have, or the water tech system we have up in our front. CO2 capture, artificial lights to really take advantage of maximized photosynthesis with dialed-in lighting recipes for different types of plants. And part of that business model too is we create a business model where we plan on giving away $100,000 worth of product every year, guaranteed, to food banks and food shelters. Because we honestly believe that you shouldn't have to have money, you shouldn't have to go to a three-star Michelin restaurant to eat the highest quality food you could. Everybody deserves to have good quality, healthy food. And so part of my mission and sort of the way that we're seeing going forward is to create a business model, or a 21st century greenhouse business model based around aquaponics. That will be a community-supported type of thing, where it'll be the idea of a community hub where people can come and buy their fresh fish and their fresh produce directly from the farm, and also be able to support local restaurants as well, but also to support the disadvantaged members of our community. So that's one of the great things that I'm looking forward to in the future. And stay tuned with us. You know, probably in the next year or two, we'll have some announcements about something like that.
Wow, that sounds, you got me like shivering here, just hearing you. Like, I want that to happen so bad. All right, so Ken, is there any final comments or words of wisdom you'd like to share with my gardeners, other fellow aquapons, or just people getting interested in aquaponics today?
Yeah, get into it. Just do it. Start with a small scale system. Don't build a large farm right off the bat. That's what I did. The mistakes are a little bit expensive when you do it that way. And whether it's aquaponics or not, any sort of soil garden, I think it's really important that people grow their own food, have their victory gardens, have their own food systems as well, whether it's aquaponics or hydroponics or aeroponics or soil-based gardening. I think it's really important for everybody to just get into it, to start learning how food systems, how food grow and the different types of food, and grow what you like. There's lots of food out there. There may be the special things that you can't always get, so grow those things in your backyard. I think it's, and for aquaponics and people that are interested, just get into it, give it a try. Start with a little small scale system and then just grow from there. It's an extremely rewarding, it's a fun experience, an extremely rewarding experience, and I don't think you'll ever either be disappointed either in an aquaponics system or growing your own food.
Wonderful. I'm glad you said all that, because yeah, I mean, I want you guys to grow your own stuff as well also. So, Ken, if somebody wants to get a hold of you, your farm, come for a tour, come for one of your classes, buy some of your amazing produce that I got to sample today, how can somebody do that?
Yeah, so the ways that you can get a produce, you can visit our farm. We're here in Half Moon Bay. The best way is to visit our website. We're at ouroborosfarms.com, spelled OUROBOROSFARMS.com. That's the best way to check out the various classes and the tours and the various things we have, and have some more information about our farm. If you'd like to enjoy our produce, we're open from 10 to 5 from Tuesday through Friday, so you can come here and meet one of our farmers and talk to us and buy some produce or fish directly. If you want a fresh fish for dinner, we will harvest it out of our system for you, kill it in the most humane way possible, and then you can take that fish home and have it for dinner. You can also visit one of our restaurant partners. We do sell mostly to restaurants here in the Half Moon Bay coast. There are a couple in San Mateo, a couple restaurants in I should probably mention the restaurant. So the Half Moon Bay Brewery, a Miramar Beach restaurant, Sam's Chowder House, Dad's Luncheonette, the Ritz-Carlton here in Half Moon Bay, the Mountain House, which is up in Woodside. We sell to Malm and Zola's down in Palo Alto. We sell to Viognier, which is in San Mateo. And then if you want the really fine dining experience with the best stuff we can get, we sell to both Aquarello, which is a 2 Michelin starred restaurant in San Francisco, and Bennu, which is a 3 Michelin starred restaurant in San Francisco. If you can't find yourself here and you live in the Bay Area, the best way to get our produce is through a company called Good Eggs. They're an online grocery delivery service, $60 or more worth of groceries, and it's free delivery to your home. And we have about 15 different produce items that you can get through them. So if you want to try some of our salad or some of our chard or kale or any of the various items that we grow here, you can get them through there and have it directly delivered right to your home.
Wonderful. Yeah, so I'll put a link down to his website down below so you guys can check him out. All right, so that's it for this episode. If you guys enjoy this episode, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. If I get lots of thumbs up, next time I'm in the area, I'll try to come by and make more videos here, because there's so many things I didn't cover.
And I just love being at this place and actually eating some of the food here as well. Super delicious. Also, be sure to share this video with somebody else. Share it on an aquaponics group. Share it with other people that may be interested in aquaponics. Share it with people that live in here in the local San Mateo, San Francisco, Santa Clara County area so they can learn about this amazing farm that I got to visit today. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes that have come out about every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll show up or I'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,400 episodes at this time on this channel dedicated to teaching you guys and sharing with you guys all the different ways to grow food as well as visiting many farms so I could learn and you guys could learn along with my journey. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing.